Good evening, friends. It gives me great pleasure to invite all of you for this fireside chat with which Raghu will have with Mr. Dilip Swamiji. I really don't want to take any time, so let me make it the briefest welcome speech in the history of welcome speeches. Thank you all for being here. Thank you, Professor Bhaskar, for being here, and if I can request you to say a few words, please. Thank you.
Good evening to all of you, and welcome to this edition of Walks, which is a series that the IIT Alumni Center runs. Today we are very, very privileged to have with us one of the doyens of India's pharma industry, Mr. Dilip Swamiji. That he's chosen, he's one of the pioneers of the pharma industry in India. He is also currently the chairman of IIT Bombay, our sister institution. He's kind enough to spend 3 hours with us today. He spent some time on the campus, some time seeing a few things in the research part, and now he's here for this. Gopal referred to ominously as a fireside chat. Chennai doesn't need firesides, so we'll call it the beachfront chat. Okay? Anyway, so I think I don't want to say anything more. I'll just leave it to Raghu, the CEO of our Gopalakrishnan Deshpande Center for Innovation and Entrepreneurship, who's going to engage Mr. Swamiji in this conversation. Thank you.
Am I audible there?
Yeah, thank you.
So Mr. Swamiji, welcome to the Alumni Club and the Research Park at IIT Madras. We're really, grateful that you've been able to take time out of your schedule and come here and share with us your views. Let me give you a brief introduction. I think Mr. Swamiji really doesn't need an introduction, but there are some facts that are well worth repeating and well worth knowing. Mr. Swamiji is actually a commerce graduate, but for the last couple of hours, I think the amount of knowledge that he has, expounded or even displayed as humbly as you can about life sciences, about chemistry, and about physics, and all of those, puts many of us to shame who are qualified engineers. So really, really taken aback by that. So he's a commerce graduate. In 1983, he started a drug company. I think he started by selling drugs. And over a period of about 30 years, which is really, really very, very short, he built what is India's largest company, in the pharmaceutical space. And today, it is the largest specialty generic company in the world. It's number one in India, as I said. It has 41 manufacturing plants, all over the world, many of them outside of India. And I think there's more than 2,000 products. Probably the largest for any pharmaceutical company. And he was awarded the Padma Shri by the Government of India in 2016. So clearly, it's an achievement worth applauding for, I would say. So, welcome to IIT Madras and the Research Park.
Thank you. I think nice to be here. I spent the last 2 hours meeting faculty members and also startups, and I'm quite impressed with the kind of work that is being done. I'm very impressed with
So what we'll do is, for the next hour, we'll have a chat, we'll try and tease a lot of wisdom out of Mr. Swamiji. It's not just in science and pharmaceuticals and pharmacology, but I think there's a lot of people out here who are young researchers, young engineers, faculty, and of course entrepreneurs. We try and see how much of how best we can make use of 1 hour with you today. So what we'll do is we'll probably have a chat with Dilip Bhai for the next 45 minutes, and after that we will we'll elicit some questions from all of you. Given that we have a shortage of time, I'd request you to write your question out, then pass it on to some volunteers who will get it to us, and then we will try and see if some questions need to be consolidated. We'll do that. So that's just in interest of time that we'll do that. So Mr. Sanghvi, you started with just 10,000 rupees of capital. That's what we understand. That's what media tells us that we is that correct?
Yeah, that's correct.
So with just 10,000 rupees of capital in Calcutta in 1983 or 82, and today Sun Pharma is a $4.5 billion conglomerate with a market capitalization of $22 billion. These numbers are staggering. So I think it's well worth understanding what has gone beyond this. So I think over the course of the next 45 minutes, what have we, what we can learn in science, what we can learn in engineering, in management, in entrepreneurialism, all of that is probably what we try and extract from you. Tell us, sir, as you founded Sun Pharma in 83 and as it grew, what vision did you have, for it as you started? And, did you think it would grow so big in so short a time? And please relive your thoughts for us. How have they changed over time? And how have you adapted to, the changing circumstances and brought some warnings to you?
So clearly, I don't think that at that point of time, I had any clue as to how big we will become. I can only tell you an anecdote, and my wife keeps on reminding me of that, is that when we got engaged, which was around a year after I started the company, and in that year we had done a turnover of around 15 lakh rupees. So, and you brag with the person who's getting married to you, so tend to exaggerate. So I told her that if we are successful, we can do 1 crore rupees a year. I mean, that is what I could see as what is the business potential. I had no idea about the size of market in India. I had no idea about global markets. And beyond what I was doing, I had very little understanding. But I think business teaches you. You constantly learn from others who are more successful than you. You learn from people who have done well. And also you learn what not to do from people who are not very successful. But philosophically, I think what we've always believed and focused on is that in our business, people are our assets. So always focus on nurturing, empowering, also growing with the people. And I have always believed that
the ability to commit yourself sometimes allows a person to give or deliver outcome which is far, far higher than some people who are very bright but don't commit themselves. So I think fortunately for us, we have a great team which is also bright and committed.
Well, that's a very simplistic and good answer. You said you have certain role models. Can you share any role models that you had in mind that you followed implicitly or less specifically?
So I think initially I continue to learn from people who are extremely successful in Indian farming industry, like Dr. Hani, Dr. Anjali, Parvinder Singh. And I also learned from, let's say, companies which at one point of time used to be very successful, called, say, let's say, Tennis Pharmaceutical or PCI. And I would look at what made these companies allow them to scale and why these companies could not scale and kind of fell behind. So, but over time, I think you then look at international leaders as we started becoming more global. Is that how do we internationalize the business? Where do you invest? How do you invest? How much do you invest for short-term return, medium-term return, and long-term return? How do you predict the
direction that the business is likely to take in the next few years. Because business is kind of a game of football. The guy who scores the maximum number of goals is not necessarily the one who runs the fastest. He anticipates where the ball is likely to come and he positions himself ahead of time there. In business also, I think if I see we, part of it may be accidentally, but we went into therapy areas like cardiology, gastroenterology, which India is, when we started, was a market of something like, say, 3,000 crore rupees. But 80% of that market was anti-infectives, painkillers, nutritional products, cardiology products, and psychiatry, neurology. These are very, very small therapies. The total size of psychiatric market when we started was less than, I think, 10 crore rupees. So, and today I think our largest product in psychiatry would be around 50 crore rupees. So, these therapy areas grew much more faster than anti-infectives, painkillers. So today I think the largest therapy area in the country is cardiology, unlike anti-infectives. So we positioned ourselves ahead of time. So it didn't cost us a lot of money for developing that leadership position in those therapy areas. And the other thing which I always learned is that if you find a way to empower people, then you need to give them business which they can manage. If you give them very complex businesses, it becomes very difficult for everybody to manage. So we run our business in India not like one large business, but we run it like multiple small businesses. So we have what you call cluster heads who are managing different therapy areas. And they manage that business as a self-standing business. And leaving aside a few basic constant in rest of the company like norms like salary, reimbursement, processes, they have significant flexibility in managing their marketing strategy and various other things. Like building a small unit within a larger unit has helped us do much better than competition.
So you have a small company mentality, that's what you've simulated between your large.
I always believe that if you reduce the distance between the customer and the point at which the decision is taken, you are able to respond much faster.
Okay. I'll switch to a slightly global question. How do you describe the key contribution to the Indian pharmaceutical industry to the world?
Do you see
India's position and role, the global pharmaceutical industry, changing as you go ahead for the next decade? Also,
I think there are two questions which you are asking. One question is, what is the impact and the role of Indian pharmaceutical companies which are run by Indians in India? There are also large number of Indians who are running pharmaceutical companies outside of India, but they are also very successful. So I see a significant role that is played by Indians globally in pharma business. I think there are some reasons. One is our business is very complex, and because of the way in which our country works, I think our mind works very differently. And because the way we work, rather than what you call trying to change the rules, we try and perform within the given rules. So, and the third most important reason which I see why ADF become very successful globally is that pharmacy course in India is much more industrial pharmacy than globally. So like in the US there is a 6-year course called PharmD. Now Form D will essentially make you 60% doctor. So focus is much more on drugs, side effects, pharmacology and various other things. Whereas in India, B Pharm or M Pharm, those people will learn how to make tablets and how to make slow release tablets and how to make transdermal patches. So much more focused on industrial pharmacy. And these subjects are taught only in the US in post-graduation or in PhD students. So that way we have a very large supply of very qualified industrial pharmacists which is available in the country. And they've done not only well in India, but when I go to, let's say, research centers outside of India in any country, and I see very many Indians have very important position in all of these countries.
Is that an advantage that will continue?
I believe so.
Well, the reason I ask is, you know, like in many industries, and you know, this research part is also kind of an instrument in that. You know, we have technology changing in many ways, like big data coming in. You have analytics, you have IoT, sensor technology, innovation in healthcare. All kinds of factors where technology is coming in. So do you see all of that impacting the Indian pharmaceutical industry favorably, adversely? What kind of changes are required?
Well, there will have to be. So like the first important transition that we need to achieve is ability to develop innovative differentiated products. For a very long period of time in the country, I think there was no premium on innovative thinking. So we, because we had no patents, we had no what we call additional reward for taking risk and developing a new product. So when you copy a product, then you don't take so many risks of failure, because if you're able to copy, then it will work. But what it takes away is the ability to identify new problems that you can find a way to solve. And what I think impressed me today in the various startups that I saw is that they have identified a problem which they think that their approach or their the technology which they will develop that will solve that problem. So anytime we start thinking about solving a problem and if we are successful, then I think we bring a product which has ready customers. And your question, I think, is much more towards the impact of technology in terms of how healthcare and how medical behavior will. I don't think I have a fully developed view yet on that subject. But what I understand and what I see also globally is that increasingly larger percentage of the healthcare budget is being spent on smaller and smaller percentage of patients, to an extent where they say that 2% of the patient population will possibly consume 80% of the budget of the healthcare budget of developed countries. So it's a very different kind of problem. Say orphan indications which apply to a relatively small subset of patients. So and if you see the way in which I think companies are adopting to this is very different. So like if you see BMS. Now BMS, from a situation where it used to be a very large company with maybe thousands of representatives everywhere, is now focusing on relatively small diseases. Most of the products it has in development and are in market cost anywhere between $30,000-$50,000 to $200,000 a year per patient. So it's from a general diabetes and hypertension product, it's become a specialty pharma. And I see that happening for Merck, especially because their anti-cancer Keytruda is extremely successful. And they are kind of walking away from their main
therapeutic areas. But that also is significantly influenced by pricing. So that they are able to charge $100,000, $200,000 per patient a year. So overall healthcare and disease burden in a country like India is going to be very different than the disease burden that we will see globally. And we have done in India, like within the business, create smaller businesses. We have to continue to find solutions so that we can address problems of India as well as find a way to succeed in the US.
One of the areas where the Indian pharmaceutical industry has been very successful is this generic segment. Why is it that India is so successful in generics? You know, it's wildly successful, if I could say that. And a related question, you know, how ahead are we of China? You know, because China comparison comes up in all manufacturing and in general at every level. So are we, I mean, this seems to be an industry where we are ahead of China. It appears to be so. And definitely the generic space we are. So why is that so? And how consistent, I mean, is that a sustainable gap that we have?
Like I think I said about the, we were ahead of China in terms of getting into pharma business, and that I think has allowed us to become more successful in regulated markets. Also, I think we speak English, China, there is challenge in terms of speaking English. But I see Chinese companies catching up very rapidly. And some of the companies, like they bought recently a company in India, they couldn't buy 100%, but they got 76% of the company in India. And they are not, that company has no interest in India. Their essential interest is in US and Europe, which are large markets. So they want to learn from success that Indian companies have been able to make. Now, how successfully they are able to assimilate and use it to compete up with us. But on the other side, I think what is happening is that in the US especially, customers are consolidating. Today in the US, four customers represent almost 85% of the market for generic products. And their ability to determine success or failure of companies linked to it, and also allows them to negotiate very aggressively with companies for pricing. So that is creating pricing pressure for US, for Indian companies. So we have to find a way to compete not only with other Indian companies, but also find a way to get into higher margin businesses in the US.
Complex generics.
Complex generics. Also some differentiated products for which you have intellectual property. So like I think if I see in case of Sun Pharma, in last 3 or 4 years we would have committed something like $600-700 million in research funding for developing differentiated products. Hopefully first of all new chemical entity, which is a biologic, IL-23 antibody, should come to the market in first or second quarter of next year, I mean next financial year. And we expect it to be a very successful product. So we will then have an additional engine of growth.
So what I'm hearing from you, it sounds like the US is a bigger threats to Indian pharmaceutical generics particularly than China, who controls the raw material, 80% of API or bulk drugs. So is that the perception that is driving the industry today?
You have to be successful in the US, then you have to be able to maintain a stable and consistent supply chain. And it is the largest market. So you have, fortunately for us, we've been successful.
On the other hand, I think Europe, which is also another large market, but it's essentially fragmented. Each country is different. Germany is very different from UK or France or Italy. And so by a conscious decision, we decided not to enter into the pharmacy business of Europe. So we have a business in Europe essentially focused on hospital products.
One question that keeps coming, you know, again and again in several minds. Can Indian pharma companies successfully compete in innovation with global pharma companies and biotech firms? Their R&D budgets are bigger than Arthur Noble's. I mean, that's the big pharma company, and there are several of these. So when we are, right, we may have the strengths that you mentioned in terms of right people, large numbers of people, and low cost and so on. But do we have the right ecosystem and the right talent, deep pockets for new product development? Is the industry getting there slowly, or something else has to happen? Or there has to be intervention? What is your perspective?
I mean, if I see the degree of innovation, so like we have business in Israel. So when I see ecosystem and the innovation happening in healthcare sector, not only in pharma, drug discovery, delivery, or instrument devices, enormous amount of, so like there will be, there are at least 2,000 new startups in Israel alone.
In pharmacy?
In healthcare related businesses, which will include data, which will include. So, very different kind of ecosystem. And we have to learn. So, I think I have been pushing IIT Bombay to find a way to collaborate with Israeli University at a, let's say, faculty to faculty level. But ultimately, I think they will identify joint projects, and then students from both the institutes will work. Hopefully, we should start something maybe in the next 12 months or so. So, I think there is a lot to learn from Israel and the other ecosystems. So, like even in the US, if you see them, there are two ecosystems, one is East Coast and Boston, and the other is in West Coast. There is a lot to learn from them. It's not that they are smarter than us, but they work differently from us. So, how do we work there? And how do we get them?
Budget's an issue? I mean, Or is global innovation we come in our way?
No, or necessary. You know, see, today capital has no boundary. You come up with a new idea, and if you come up with a new solution, then global investors will invest in your business. So I don't see that, but why will global investor come to Chennai? They're not going to come if there is only one company. You have to create a critical mass of business here, so that they have a potential area that they can identify. And as a country also, we need to find a way to showcase our innovation, so and invite all these global investors or global companies. I think it's a process. Israel did it since last 20 years, and they've been very successful. But what I strongly believe is that some of the startups have to succeed. And I have seen that if some startup that you can relate to becomes very successful, then the feeling that if he can do it, I can do it, is so much stronger than somebody in Israel becoming successful. So I think as the startups start becoming successful, they will create 10, 20 other startups, each of them.
So it's infectious enthusiasm that goes viral. That's really what you're saying.
That's what, and that's what I have seen. At least in pharma business, I see that whatever that we did as a company, we will see that 20 of our competitors will do that in next 20, 30, I mean 2, 3 years. So, because now that we have invested in innovative products, I see that many of my competitors are investing in innovative products. Not, I mean, other companies have been investing in this kind of research for a very long time. It's only because somebody that you know starts investing, then you get a feeling that if you can, why we cannot. So that is what I think will increase the level of capability.
The competitive tension.
Yeah. And also capability.
In terms of looking at the Indian healthcare, you know, are there diseases that are inadequately addressed in India and
you know, is the pharma industry doing something about it? Because the whole issue is there's no money here. The public spending on health in India is frankly a failure. And there's not enough private money to go around. 25% of our people are, I mean, there's a very poor.
And so, you know, how does the pharmaceutical industry really look at this part? Or will universal healthcare in India just remain a pipe dream? What is your sense? How will it go?
I think clearly, if you see the largest cause of death, are for things for which there are already established drugs available. So excess is a problem. So pediatric mortality, if you see, then majority of the reason why you have pediatric mortality is because of things for which there are already solutions. It's our inability to provide that solution. So I think excess is clearly the largest
problem.
Or excess, I think whether, I don't think that with the per capita income that we have and disparity that we have, it will ever be easy to achieve affordability. But why can't we have say some basic diseases for which there is free medication available in primary healthcare center? So government needs to think of excess very differently from the way
what
is
what
is being done. So some states have done a much better job of that than the other states. So like if I see from a distance, in Tamil Nadu is clearly ahead of many other states in terms of giving access to essential medicines at primary health care center. So diseases like diabetes or hypertension, essential drugs are available free of cost to people in the hospitals.
Isn't things like direct benefit transfer, all those things would matter, or is it also a question of lack of knowledge which people should come in the way of availing even if you have money?
I think in things where government is doing this direct benefit transfer like LPG gases or things where there is a significant misuse of subsidy, because it's something which everybody uses. So what is sold at a low price is then used by intermediaries to make money. But I don't see that as an important challenge in pharma.
You hinted about this, but let me spend a little more time on innovation. What are the barriers that in India that prevail that make innovation a little less effective? At the level that you sit and you know and the dialogue that you have with industry or with government, definitely with academia, you're part of it. What are the key policy changes, particularly with respect to the pharmaceutical industry and, let's say, academics to collaborate better? You spoke about the Israel model. Yes, are there other things that can be done, should be done, which we are not doing today sufficiently?
So let's look at, so like I will tell you my experience. We have a natural product which does extremely well in terms of curing or let's say addressing dengue and the other flavoviruses. Not only dengue but many other similar class of. Now we are unable to initiate a study because last 6 months we are unable to get permission from whichever department has to give us permission to collect this vegetation from the forests. Now, there are three things which are existing in the law, which says that if I need less than 500 kg, then they don't need to ask me so many questions. So there are existing statutes, in spite of which we are not getting. Now, I don't know whether this in any way helps environment, this in any way helps ecosystem. But this bureaucracy needs to, it's a huge bottleneck. Maybe because in IIT you don't have so much of, you have far more freedom because it's operated within the institute. But otherwise in industry, huge permission bureaucratic processes. And that, I think, operates as a, it takes away speed. And when you're developing an innovative product, speed is very critical. Because you have filed a patent. Now, after filing the patent, the clock is ticking. Your period of exclusivity is limited. Now, if you can bring the product to market in a shorter period of time, you have a higher ability to capture value. If you get delayed, then you have a much smaller window of capturing value. So these, some of these operating challenges, we have to find a way to address. But I think the sheer quantum also needs to go up. Mm-hmm. And where I believe that if some of the companies are successful, it will lead to a positive spiral.
Focus a little bit on Sun Pharma. Clearly the leader in India. Now, given where the world is going, US or elsewhere, how is Sun repositioning itself in the global pharmaceutical industry, you know, as the industry says? How do you see the Indian pharma different, let's say, from 10 years from now? We could have a $30 billion business. Do you see us going to $100 billion? And in that Sun, remaining the Sun of the solar system, or is that going to be a little different? How do you see this playing out in the next decade?
So clearly, I think once your business reaches a certain size, you will need multiple engines of growth. So like we were not present in Japan. Now, 2 years back, we bought a business in Japan. And our idea is that Japan business will continue to help us in growing. So you have to become more broad-based so that whatever you are developing, you are able to leverage your development cost across large number of geographies. Second is, if you see globally, then generics are more than 80-85% of the total number of prescriptions. But
By volume.
But by value, if you look at, it will be anywhere between 15-20% or maybe less than 20% of the market. So, and we have no presence in that other 80%. So how do we successfully get into that business and become successful? And I see that in next 10 years, you will see many companies from India having some products which will allow them to leverage their presence in this business and grow there.
You see the Indian pharma business growing at the same pace or accelerating? Today we are about, I don't know, my guess is about $25 to $30 billion.
Yes.
It's more less than 30, I guess.
No, I think if you look at both organized and unorganized sector, maybe a little bit more.
A little bit more? So do you see it is becoming the next 10 years, 3 times? I mean, as affordability increases, as insurance,
Indian market clearly will be able to grow at least slightly faster than the GDP rate of growth and GDP growth. We will continue to become increasingly bigger globally. And that I'm talking about the existing business.
The generic
part of business. Then I think going forward, I expect many Indian companies also to have their innovative products. Either they will be marketing it themselves, or they will license it to other companies.
Biologics.
Biogenerics, yes. And also, like this, IL-23 antibody that we have is a biologic. So we are also working on innovative new biologics.
One question that is bothering the financial markets a lot. In the last 1 year, Indian stock markets have grown up by about 25-30%. The pharma sector has grown 25% the other way around.
Sure.
What is happening? I mean, there's a clearly a lot of strength here. Is there a structural change? I mean, what has happened?
I think increasingly, if I see, then say last year, more than 50% of the new generic approval were for Indian companies. So India is becoming an increasingly larger component of the drugs consumed by US population. So the importance of ensuring the integrity of the supply chain is an important business, what you call healthcare requirement for the FDA. So they are looking at exports, also supply us out of India with a much greater degree of focus than what they have done in the past. And that is what I think is led to some amount of disruption in companies. Like most of the large companies have some ongoing issue in one of their sites for the FDA. So that has reduced the new approvals.
This is come by just run of business, or is there some other hand at play when the business comes like that? So this is something that will reverse, you think?
I think it will only end up making us stronger. I know that it will make some firm us stronger.
So it's an aberration, you're saying, really?
It's a what you call new expectations of regulatory agencies which industry will adopt to meet.
I don't know how many of us know here, Sun has grown by making 19 acquisitions.
Am I correct? Is that number right? Or have you lost count?
So 19 acquisitions over its 30-year history. And globally, sir, you know, when you look at the M&A world, I mean, empirical evidence suggests that 80% of the time, the acquirer loses the game, loses the plot. 80%. So four-fifths of acquisitions are not successful. I'm not saying, going so far as saying they're failures, but they're not successful.
They don't create shareholders.
They don't create shareholders, they probably destroy it, or they just meander into, you know, nothing less. But in your case, they've all been successful, at least as we see. Maybe some of them are work in progress. But what we want to understand is, you know, what have you done different? What is the secret sauce? And, you know, in every case, you really got the game right. Can you share some? I mean, this would be really, really useful for a lot of people.
Sure. I believe that the first most important thing is that we've been lucky. So,
that's hardly
19 times difficult.
I mean, even the odds are against you, right?
No, but I strongly believe that there is an element of luck in almost everything that we do. But apart from that, I think, so we have a structured process. So first of all, we look at acquisitions only if they are strategic in nature. Then we look at an acquisition only if they meet certain amount of financial criteria. Then we need to be 100% sure that we can manage that business better than the current owners can. Because every acquisition that we make, we have to pay a premium. Something which has a value of 100. If you want to buy, you could buy at 125, 150, depending on the number of people you are interested. So, and also when you do an acquisition, and if it's a large acquisition, if you have to integrate, then it will also affect your ability to grow your own business. So while there are synergies, there will also be dis-synergies. So you have to factor all of this into your plan, and then if you feel confident that this is something you should do, then you go ahead and do that. And then you set up a process to review, monitor, clear objectives to be set up so that people are held accountable.
Sure.
This is standard M&A theory, you see. This is like asking Tendulkar, how do you play your cover drive so well? So he says, I see the ball, I put my foot and I hit the ball. I mean, it's as simple as that.
But that's what you
do.
That's what you do.
In terms of your acquisition, which was the most difficult one? Was it the Taro one?
The most
insights.
One is the Red Maxi acquisition. And without any other reason, it was the size of is that from managing a business of some 15,000 people, all of a sudden I would be managing a business of 30,000. Then instead of managing 20 manufacturing sites, we were managing 40 manufacturing. So the complexity of business changed overnight. And it takes time for people to manage that increased level of complexity.
So that's work in progress, clearly.
That's clearly a work in progress. We've done a few of the functional integrations completely where we have nothing to do, and some of that is still happening.
How would you describe your management style? You know, are you hands-on? One place I remember you said you're a manager. You're the founder, you're the person at the top, so you say you're more a manager. Are you more strategic? Or leave the details, to give some hint of that. Have you changed your management style over the years? So how have you done this?
No, clearly I have changed my style over time. I mean, when I was running a 2-person company, very different challenge and very different issues. Then managing, say, 150, 200 people business and doing a bigger business. And a lot of people who know me, they say that I am far more hands-on than what I should be. So I am trying to learn how not to be. Maybe I need to be aware of everything, kind of. So, well, I think functions for which we have processes, I don't have a problem. I only review. Processes which are not functions which have challenges, I am much more involved. So, and sometime I think I describe my style as a kind of a style where if a function is managed well, then I have loose controls. If function is not managed or a business is not managed well, then I have
management exception.
Yeah, much more tighter.
You've had this, as far as I can see, the only company, a family managed company, if I will, where the founder and the CEO has stepped down and brought a professional chairman. I mean, you have an outsider as a boss. Am I correct in saying that?
Yeah.
I mean, how have you, what made you do this? And I mean, it's a remarkable move. Can you share, what was your thinking and how have you been different from any corporate that we know in India?
So I think as the business size increases, the cost of making a mistake keeps on increasing. Also, indecisiveness because of lack of experience also increases. So like as we are internationalizing, as we are scaling our business, I felt that if I work with somebody, because above a certain level, you don't work for anybody or nobody works for you. You work with people. So like our manufacturing head, it doesn't work for me, work for you. He works with me. So, and that way, so I feel that I needed the help, and I am comfortable asking for it.
Great answer. By the way, I think just for clarification, Mr. Shanghvi was the chairman and managing director of Sun Pharma. He
you vacated the place of chairman, he refused to be MDC, of course, and Mr. Israel Markov, who was the CEO of Teva, which is an Israeli company, is the leading, probably the leading generic company in the world. You know, he built it from about $500 million to about $10 billion. So he brought him as chairman. Yes. So it's a great ambition and, you know, it's management style. Clearly, I think Indian management.
Actually, we recently also had we inducted Vivek Saigal as an independent director. So Vivek actually set up and he owns majority of Mathur Singh Soni. Now, Mathur Singh Soni has global leadership in auto components. He runs 240 factories with service level of something like 99.7% and defect levels of less than 2 parts per billion. So the idea is that I want to learn from it. Because if you can help us do things better and different and faster, I think it helps everybody. And I have no problem saying that there are things which he does better than what I do.
So let me go to a higher level of, you know, Indian companies are accused at one level, maybe even globally, in the case of, you know, maybe you are called priority to profits versus society versus employees, or maybe various stakeholders. You know, given that you built an enterprise which is valuable, which is contributing, which is a for-profit business and all that, what are your views on what should be the key purpose of business, at least let's say in a developing country? You know, where do profits stand in the hierarchy of business?
So I believe that profit is an important component of this hierarchy, because profit is a tool which allows you to grow the business and do many things which are not possible if you don't have profits. But should that be the only objective, or should you have bigger objectives? Because say, like when you price a product in India, whether how do you price the product? At certain price, you maybe address a relatively small part of the market, but you maybe make more money. But at a lower price, you address a larger part of the market, but you possibly don't make as much money. So in such situations, I think we've always taken a decision that I think our fundamental objective is to find a way to help patients lead a better life. Doctors to be able to treat their patients with products which will help them in sale. I'll give you examples. So like at one point of time, we were selling statins at some 20 rupees a tablet. And over time, I think I realized that, say, we had anywhere between 30 to 50% dropout. Because after a month, 2 months, people stopped taking
affordable.
So in such a situation, even though it meant reduced profit for some period of time, we decided to arbitrarily reduce our price from 20 rupees to 6 rupees. And at 6 rupees, we were actually not making any
advertising.
So because we did a market research and we said that we did the evaluation as well, which is the price point at which
it
may be
drop off.
Yeah, they, I think the dropout level will go.
So you're saying, as a principle, it's fine. So profits are important. It gives you freedom to do many things.
Profits are necessary.
It's necessary.
You can't run a business only on philanthropy. I mean, maybe.
Sure.
Well, that's a very well considered view, surely.
Let me ask the final question before we throw the floor open. What would your key message be to, you know, your young students here, your right, researchers, your energetic startups here? What are your key messages that you like?
I think they are entering the main economy at a point of time which is far more vibrant and likely to grow much faster than what was the economy when I entered the business. I clearly see huge opportunity for people who are entering the, what you call, their main career life now, both within the country as well as the outside of the country. I think the Indian economy took maybe tens of years to reach $1 trillion and the next $1 trillion. I think the speed with which it will keep on adding the next $1 trillion to the economy is going to be much, much faster. So opportunity to grow the business is very, very. At the same point of time, I think we are becoming far more closely integrated with global economy. So developed products, developed services that not only will succeed in India, but can succeed potentially globally. I see that happening. Many Indian companies are developing global products and they're globally successful. Some of the products that I saw today clearly reflect the opportunity to develop much bigger global market than India business. But since the underlying reason for product development is looking at a problem that they see in India, once the problem definition will change and will become more inclusive of problems that you see globally, then I see that opportunity of these products to solve global problems will also increase. But this world will require ability to work with many, many different, let's say, streams of science. Not, you can't solve a problem of biology only with biology. With many other areas of chemistry, electronics, software. So far more comprehensive solutions so that we create a global time. But, I always am amused at how, yeah, they are clearly very different than what I was when I was there.
How do we have 500 Sun Pharmaceuticals? I think we have so many questions here. I think, sir, you will have to take a flight tomorrow morning. Huh? So I think let's see what we can do. I'm going to kind of club some questions, you know, kind of talk to them quickly. Now, in your experiences of doing business internationally as well as in India, as well as doing acquisitions, particularly acquisitions, how was your overseas experience different from that in India? The way the business is conducted, structured.
So culturally, there are differences between people in different countries, but the underlying human psychology actually is same. Everybody wants to succeed, everybody wants to do well, and everybody is happy to be part of the winning team. So there will be differences. They eat different food, they will be culturally different, they will be drink more alcohol, or they don't drink any alcohol. So there will be cultural differences between us. They have more holidays than us, and they possibly take off on Friday evening. But everybody wants to do well. And if you can help them find a way to do well and be recognized for their contribution, then everybody works well with you. So at that level, I haven't seen any. But if I expect that people, that the way they work for us in India, they should work for us like that in Israel or in the US, then I don't think that's likely to work. So I have to have some amount of flexibility about providing for differences in different countries.
Interesting question. You neglect one inflection point that you that made your company a good exponent.
I don't think we are exploring.
Okay, assume you're exploring, but what was the one inflection point that you come across in made your company what it is today from, let's say, what it was not earlier?
So one inflection point that I think I would say is when we went public, because till that time I was kind of earning and reinvesting in business. And for the first time when we went public, I raised 55 crores. And that is the amount of money that I would have made within 4 or 5 years. So it gave me the flexibility to invest this, and that's when we did a few acquisitions, including our entry into the US market. So this injection of money helped us do things which would have otherwise taken us much longer to do.
It's a question just slightly outside your pharmaceutical business. You actually have investments in renewable energy. You know, probably not only the family office and Sun, I'm not clear.
No, not out of Sun, right?
But you have some investments and interest in that. But given that the power tariff, particularly in renewable energy, both are falling, and do you see the sector going, you know, the way it's going? Even also the fact that they hold a lot of raw material and land, they are very land intensive, most of them. The fact that
that
is falling, what is your sense of the future?
Actually, I think I see that for the first time, renewable energy is actually more economical than thermal power. So, conventional logic will indicate that if you can produce something cheaper than what your competitor can produce, then you have a great future. So I don't see a reason for renewable energy not to do well. Fact is that because of the innovation and ability to bring down the cost of generation, and because of certain way in which the auctions were conducted, the tariffs have gone down. And some of the tariffs were
not sustainable.
Not economical at that point of time. I don't want to say that they are not sustainable. So what happened is that faced with that problem, industry quickly, so like I know in case of Suzlon, that our new models of wind turbine are actually costing us only 5-6% more and produce 25% more power for the same footprint. So clearly that will reduce my cost of generation by 25-30%. So, and at that pricing, I expect that people will be able to make money. So I say, like if I see announcements made by government of India, then government says that they want to install at least 10,000 megawatt of wind power every year for the next 5 or 6 years. Highest that India has ever installed in a single year is 5,500 megawatt. So from that, the volume is going to double. So I see a, and once you start producing that quantum, then you not only are competitive in India, but you are also competitive globally.
Okay. In terms of IP, you know, intellectual property and patenting, you know, India is probably really significant as a lot. When you look at countries like China and Korea, they're far more, you know, robust and aggressive at filing. What would your advice be to researchers in biotech and chemistry, particularly in drug discovery, to handle a global IP regime?
filing patents or dealing with patents only fine?
Patenting itself, I think, don't mean anything. You have to have patents which are licensed and patents for which you earn royalty. Then you have value. Filing a patent, I don't think you achieve anything. So, I think we have to move from, because I see that institutes are starting to look at their ability to file the number of patents as a kind of a metrics by which they are measuring their performance. I think they should start looking at the amount of royalty that they are collecting out of this patent which are licensed as a much more predictable metrics for their performance.
That is, file good patents, that's what you mean.
That is what I'm saying. So if you find good patent, you will solve a problem which is actual value creation capacity, then people will license and people will pay for it.
Okay, we still have some time, because you have to flag me. What is your view on Ayurveda as a science in terms of developing it as a market for products for global market?
I think it is a very interesting heritage that we have. As a company, we haven't done much, but I talked about this product for Delhi, natural product for Delhi. But we are seriously looking at creating capacity to look at natural products. But I think there is a big opportunity and a big market, so we can see that company like Himalaya doing extremely well, not only well in India, but also globally.
Can you elaborate a bit on the story of this natural drug? You spoke about it earlier, but how did it come about that you have 2,000 products category? How did this happen?
It was as a part of Renbaxy acquisition. It's an acquired asset. So Renbaxy had a research collaboration with CSIR and ICGED, which is a research institute in Delhi. And in that, they were doing two things. ICGED independently was working on a dengue vaccine, and they were collaborating with Renbaxy for screening various plant-based products which work against dengue. So now they have this product. And then subsequently we licensed the dengue vaccine, which we are in the process of developing further. And that's part of our, I think, CSR research.
Is 3D printing relevant in the pharmaceutical business, or is that just a wild thought?
Actually, recently a drug got approved in US, which is a 3D printed tablet. It's a product called Levetiracetam, which is 3D printed. I do not know. Well, if you can't do what a tablet can do, then what is the value? I mean, if you can do something which a tablet cannot do, then there is a value. Because otherwise, from a cost of production point of view, a 3D printed tablet will always be more expensive to produce.
It's a different business model. It gets decentralized, digitally stored and distributed.
No, you can't. You need to have all the material, all the equipment. So you can't. You can't, let's say, from same machine make 20 products, because we have contamination issues.
So it's not really practicable.
Yeah, it's not
is this threat of super bugs, is this something terrible? Is there, do we have effective medicines? Is there something to worry about?
Yeah, I think it's a big challenge, especially for hospital-acquired infection, where you have bugs which are resistant to all known treatment. So in the US now, they have changed the standard for approval of new antibiotics. And we have also created a special award for people who develop drugs for resistant kind of bacteria. So, with a view to encourage investment in that area.
This question, you know, keeps coming up everywhere, so let me ask it, you know. What will it take for Indian pharma companies to develop new molecules? How far are we?
Not far.
Are you announcing one soon, sir?
No, that's what I said. We have a new product coming sometimes next year.
It's a molecule.
It's a new molecule.
It's a new molecule. And you see other pharma companies?
So we have two other products in phase two. One is for Parkinson's disease, the other is for cancer. And they are doing extremely well in the phase two studies.
Do you see a lot more other companies in India?
Yeah, I see that. That's what I said, that in 10 years we will see companies.
You will see blockbusters from India.
Hopefully, yes.
Glad to hear that from someone like you, so that's a great job. It's a very personal question here. Let me see, let me read the way it's written here. So, what do you think makes you different from others? And what do you think is the most important thing in life? So, I do this.
Actually, all my life I have tried not to be different from others. So the idea I think I have always is that I don't want to kind of allow whatever that I have been able to achieve to go to my head. Because when I look at what we've done in our company, I think it's very small compared to what many people have been able to do in a much shorter period of time of their life. So I think once you start feeling great about yourself, your ability to learn, your ability to accept that there are different and better ways of doing things than what you're thinking of, keeps on going down. So that's one of the reasons why I try not to come on television, not to come on. I don't like when people come to notice me. So.
The publicity shirt. I can vouch for that. You know, I was trying to research to ask what to ask him, and I found it very hard to get any statements from him. So that's. I think that's really what we have, sir. Thank you very much for being candid with us, giving us your insights in the pharmaceutical industry on innovation.
I think I'm happy that I got to see some of the things that students here are doing. And it's actually quite what I would call enlightening for me to see people look at problems very differently. How to solve what is problems. So I think great kind of work both at the academic level as well as at student level. I think I wish all of you all the very best. And thank you for listening.
Very enlightening and absorbing 60 odd minutes. Thank you, sir. Thank you for being with us and sharing some wonderful thoughts. Thank you, Raghutam, for putting it together. We have tea and refreshments being served outside. Please do join us, stay back. And probably we can have some questions offline. Thank you very much.